our last episode, we danced our way through joy. This week, we visit with the one and only Dr. Cornel West.
And I am blessed beyond measure to be on the show of my magnificent sister, Nina, and she's telling you, hello, somebody.
The intellectual, intergalactically known intellectual, himself, philosopher, political activist, social critic, author, Dr. Cornel West. We start our journey with Dr. West by talking about the blues. Blues is folk music that is filled with so much emotion. It captures pain, injustice, lost love, and the yearning for a better life. It was an art form that is truly American in its origins, as it was created by African Americans through work songs and spirituals. This all happening in the 1870s. African American slave songs such as field hollers, work songs, and spirituals encapsulate the heart and the soul of the blues.
Good God Almighty.
Great blues artists like W.C. Handy, who was considered the father of the blues. Or Ma Rainey, who's considered the mother of the blues. You got sisters like Bessie Smith and B.B. King, one of his famous songs, The Thrill Is Gone. Or Muddy Waters, Hoochie Coochie Man.
The gypsy woman told my mother before I was born, I got a boy child coming. You're gonna be a son of a gun.
Hello, somebody. Jimi Hendrix, Red House. The blues come in all forms, from classic blues to country blues. Can you hear the musicians playing the juke joints? Lots of musicians roamed all over the South bringing this music. So we connect this moment, the blues as an art form, with what we are going through today. The pain, the yearning for a better life, injustice, calling all of those things out.
Ooh. Is this a blues moment, Doc?
It's a profound blues moment, but the blues is the most magnificent mode of being in the world and form of engaging the world that we know in the modern world. You a blues sister and I'm a blues brother. And the blues is about style, smile, wrestling with catastrophe, compassion, creativity, connecting the best to your past, and then passing on the best to those who come after. It doesn't get better than that, but it's a whole lot of heartache.
Yes.
A whole lot of bloodstained, tear-soaked banner you trying to hold up in such a cruel world. But if you don't allow that cruel world to get you down, and you are a living witness of what it is to be a blues queen.
Ooh, I like that.
Then you're deeper than a blues queen.
Blues queen.
That's the combination of ferocious intellect. That's you. Deep soul. That's you. Loving heart. That's you. And bearing witness, because, you know, ain't no Bernie Sanders campaign without Sister Nina at the core of it. In so many magnificent ways, and that's been true in your life, and it will be true up until the worms get you. That's the kind of person you are, blues queen.
Blues queen.
That's Ma Rainey. That's Bessie Smith. That's Aretha. That's Gladys Knight. That's Phyllis Hyman.
Yes, Patti LaBelle.
It doesn't get better than that. I'm, Lord, that's like my mama too. You know what I mean?
Yes. How mama doing?
Oh, mom strong. 88 years young. 88 years young. Isn't that
what a blessing? Yes.
Good God Almighty.
Doc, while we're on the blues, I mean, you talked about catastrophe.
Yes.
Given what's going on right now from Corona to the civil and social unrest, the people out in the streets giving voice to pain, what is it about the blues that can inform the way we move in this moment? And what lessons can we learn from the blues to apply to this moment?
Yeah. Well, one is that, see, the blues comes from a people who have been in the midst of an empire and a white supremacist civilization that viewed itself as innocent. And so James Baldwin used to say it's not permissible that the authors of devastation would view themselves as innocent. Innocence itself is a crime. So the blues are in the midst of that situation of people viewing themselves as innocent, but bringing down catastrophe on the folk.
Yeah.
And then we then have to come up with mature ways of being on intimate terms with that catastrophe while these folk parading around in innocence, in denial, in evasion of the catastrophe. Because that's the history of white supremacy in America, you see. It's sitting there like, as a catastrophe, and they deny it. Not in the U.S. Constitution, gag rule in the Congress, you can't talk about it. But then you end up with a civil war, right, over an institution not in your Constitution. So the blues has to do is a response in part to that childishness, that adolescent sense, that Peter Pan mentality, never growing up, a Disney World orientation of everything's fun all the time. Everybody got smiles. Donald Duck breakdancing on Main Street, and we out here catching hell. Blues comes in and says, we are on intimate terms with a catastrophe. They are denying, but we then come up with a fortitude. We fortify ourselves. We equip ourselves. We prepare ourselves to live lives of such misery. And out of that misery, create delicacy, empathy. There's never been a people in the modern world that for 400 years been so chronically hated. And yet, for us to dish out so much love and love warriors,
love.
Teach the world how to love. So that's where John Coltrane's Love Supreme comes from.
Yeah.
Stevie Wonder's Love and the Need of Love. Or Ray Charles's Love About America, the Beautiful. And you know it's America he can't see. Not just this.
Ooh.
He can't see it in his own experience if he could physically see.
Yes.
But he got vision to seeing something in the midst of that America, the Beautiful, starting with his mom.
Ray Charles did that.
Oh,
he did that. That's the best rendition
ever sung about this particular empire and democratic experiment. It has replaced all forms of the national anthem, and Marvin Gaye's version of the national anthem was as deep as he can get.
Yes, even though that
Marvin got to step back to Ray on that scene.
That's true, Doc. Even although that song was not made for us to sing.
That's exactly right. But we made it our own.
We made, as we do everything.
Made it our own. Monk used to say, play yourself, Train. Play yourself. Don't play anybody else. Yeah. Play yourself.
Ooh, Doc. Oh, you go on.
That's what you do. Sister Nina, you play yourself. You are true to yourself in terms of what has gone into the shaping of your heart, mind, soul, and body in a great tradition of a people dishing out love warriors, hated every day, mistreated every day, pushed back every day, but still bouncing back every day. You see, the blues is about bounce back. Intimate terms with catastrophe, here come the creativity. Intimate terms of calamity, here comes the compassion. Now, I'm not saying that we get that by osmosis or skin pigmentation, because you got a lot of black thugs and gangsters who don't give a god dang about it. Empathy, a whole lot of other things.
True that.
Of a tradition, if they made the choice to be in contact with the best of their tradition, it would have some deep resources. And of course, human beings do that across the board too. I mean, Jewish brother Robert Zimmerman, growing up in Minnesota, renamed himself Bob Dylan. He said, look, I'm gonna learn something from the geniuses coming out of Delta, Mississippi, the blues men. I'm going to be a vanilla blues man. Bruce Springsteen did the same thing from working class vanilla town in New Jersey. He is so blues is something that is chosen and cultivated over time. It's not gained by means of osmosis. So it's choices people make, but a community that has been mistreated under white supremacist abuse collectively created the blues. And then on to the jazz, and of course, spirituals as a backdrop, and then we headed toward hip-hop.
Ooh, you better talk about that, Doc.
Hip-hop. Now, you from Ohio.
Ohio
is the center of Funkville.
Yes, Ohio player.
Ohio Lakeside, Ohio players. We can go on and on and on. Something about Ohio. Gerald Levert, the greatest soul singer of his generation. We can go on and on with Ohio. But that's part of the same tradition of Black freedom tied to a Black love, dishing out creativity, teaching the world how to love, but we still hate it.
Doc, that preaches. So why is it, though? Because you hit on something when you talked about we have to bounce back and the fortitude, and we most hated people generationally, just hated, this hate.
Over generation after generation. Looks like we're going to finally break through. Here it comes back again.
I know, every time we take some steps. So I'm trying to, you know, I had an encounter a few weeks ago with somebody, you know, you got a lot of these liberal whites who don't have a clue about what racism really is. They think, and even we, I mean, all of us, let me step back. Everybody in this country that was born in this country, raised in this country, was socialized.
That's right.
In a certain way. Absolutely. So all of us can embody notions of racism. Racism, especially when it comes to anti-Blackness, but what people need to understand, racism is about a power conscious, it's a power relationship. It's not just about individual prejudices. It is about one group using their power to create a superiority that hampers the growth and development and prosperity and pursuit of happiness of another group institutionally.
That's it.
And thereby looking at that other group as somehow inferior, whether through pseudoscience or through using religion. That is racism. And so you have so many hashtag woke, so-called woke resistance folks who think that racism is just Donald Trump. They think racism is just tiki torch carrying white folks. They think racism is just the Klan in a white sheet, but they forget the barking dogs that were sicked on Black folks by law enforcement, the water holders, those were men in uniform, the politicians over the course, you know. So, Doc, please, can you help us? Because I got into it with this lady. And she,
what was she talking about?
She lucky I know Jesus.
Oh, Lord, I know Jesus, but all the time, sometimes my Holy Ghost just leaves.
It just leaves us.
Sometimes it leaves.
And what she did was she made a blanketed statement, number one, about Jill Stein, and we'll have to revisit that. That really gets to me that these weak-kneed neoliberals always want to talk about Dr. Jill Stein. The last time I checked, this is America. She had a right to run.
Absolutely.
If her running messes with your mind or gives you something is wrong with you. And then so she wrapped Kanye into this because Yee said he was going to run. We all knew he wasn't going to run. He had already dropped out. But the premise was that Yee was being just like Jill Stein, and that she was going, that he was going to take votes of Black, young Black votes from Biden. So I rejected the premise. I said Black votes are not owned by anyone.
Absolutely.
And whoever's running, whoever they are, they must earn that vote.
That's just the word I was going to. That's exactly right.
And I told her, your connotation is racist. It assumes that Blacks can't think for themselves. It assumes we are monolith. It takes away our agency. But she didn't get that. So this chick decides, you know, to dress me down. She called me bitter. Said I can't comprehend. And then she proceeded to say she was going to call Sister Stacey Abrams on me, get me straightened out. Now I'm paraphrasing all of it. Now she said those exact words. I'm shortening it for you. But yeah, this is what she did. She's one of those woke so-called liberal. So, Doc, for the love of God, this was Deborah messing with her mess. And I called her the leader of the Karen Coalition. Yes, I did. Doc, can you really explain? You are a teacher. You are an intellectual warrior now, but you study this stuff. Race matters. I mean, your book about the radical Dr. King. We got to have a part two, Doc, on this, because this ain't enough.
You know, I'll come back anytime you want. Now, you know that.
Doc, I want people to understand what racism is, and that is not just enough to point the finger at that madman in the White House, that covert and overt racism exists, and sometimes the most dangerous form of racism is the covert form. Can you take us to school?
Absolutely. Absolutely. No, indeed. Well, see, part of the problem is that there's too many vanilla liberals and neoliberals define racism as the distance between them and the Ku Klux Klan and Donald Trump, and don't realize that in their own self-righteousness, in their own arrogance, in their own condescension and haughtiness, looking down on other Black folk, telling Black folk what they ought to do and think as if they authorize their reality for Black people, and Black people must come through them to see whether it's all right for them to vote who they think they ought to vote for, think why they ought to think, behave how they ought to behave. No, racism is breaking from the notion that you define how other people define reality.
Come on.
It's a difficult thing, you see.
Yes, sir.
It's a difficult thing because white supremacy cuts so very deep. And of course, it cuts deep in Black people, too. It's in the soul of Black people, too. We got to fight it. But white brothers and sisters got to fight it too. And this includes our progressives. It includes our leftists. And it certainly includes the liberals and the neoliberals. Because the liberals and the neoliberals have been able to get along with this very milquetoast notion of diversity and inclusion so that they can reinforce the hierarchy that they remain at the top of, even as they include and invite others to come in. Come into my room and sit at my table, and I see my table's more colorful, so I have diversity. I'm including everybody, but I'm defining who sits at the table, how the table is built, what food is on the table, what the icebox and the refrigerator is that's producing the food on the table. Just come and sit and feel like you're included. Well, you see, that's still racist at a deep level. It's just better than the Klan. The Klan gonna lynch you, and they gonna invite you to the table. You say, well, you know what? I got my own table.
That's right.
I got my own chair, you know, and I don't necessarily eat your kind of food. I got some other food.
Come on.
And in fact, you can always come to our place now. That's been the history of Black people, right? We got our own churches. Y'all come on into our church. We can't go to your church. Come on in. Yes. Jesus loves you. You can join the choir if you get your beak together.
Yeah.
You can join the deacon board because you're a decent person. You know, that's your Black folk. But we're going to define the reality because every people ought to define their reality.
Black Come on.
Ought not be defining white folk, brothers and sisters, reality.
Yes.
Human beings like everybody else. And we all come together with our different conceptions of reality because in the end, we're born the same way. We're going to die. We laugh, we love the basic human features of all of us, no matter what color. But we know white supremacy wants to say, no, y'all less than, you're less beautiful, you're less moral, and you're less intelligent. And that thing's been around for so many years, every nook and cranny of the civilization, so that we had to fight it all the time, including our liberal and neoliberal brothers and sisters, but also progressive.
Yes, sir. So you're right about that, Doc. We all have to deconstruct.
We all got to fight it.
Yes, we do. Just the fact that she felt so comfortable, Doc, and she dug into that thing. I mean, we went back and forth, and she went deeper and deeper and deeper into it. And it is people like her who do not see that what they are doing, when you take away of people's agency, I mean, just to single out Black folks, rap is the most, hip-hop is the most listened to art form in the world, and more white brothers and sisters listen to it. But she felt the urge, you know, that that superiority to just call out black folks. And I had to check her on it, Doc. And my premise is this. This is America, so anybody who wants to run has a right to run. That's it. You don't have to agree with them running. You don't have to agree with their platform or if they don't have a platform. But for people who claim that they want equality and justice, to tell another man or another woman what they cannot do,
that's right,
doesn't make sense to me. And so we really need to have a universal civic history lesson about racism, about anti-blackness, about white supremacy, and also about the dynamics in this country where some people believe that they have a right to tell other people what they can do and what they cannot do, and not see that what they are doing is perpetuating the very thing that they said that they were against in the first
place. I don't
understand it. Right. So, Doc, so you have said you cannot lead people if you do not love people. Can you go there for us?
Yeah, because you see, the first love is about learning how to die. Something inside you has to die for something to be reborn. It's like when you fall in love, your old egoistic, narcissistic self has to in some way die because you become entangled with somebody else and you feeling a new sense of what it is to be human when you with that person. It's like when you fell in love with my dear brother. Y'all came together in new beings, something in both of you all died in order for something inside of you all to be reborn. And what was reborn was a joy to being together. What was reborn was a sense of newness, of being on a new adventure. And so love goes hand in hand with that vulnerability, invincibility, and humility, leading toward an intimacy. And therefore, when you actually love folk, and you want to not just lead, but be with them in their struggle, something inside of you got to die, a certain kind of fear, certain kind of narcissism, certain kind of egotism, a certain sense of always being concerned about yourself. You are concerned about service to others. It's like when you fall in love with a person or when your baby's born. Oh, you look at the sparkle in the eye of your baby, and all of a sudden, all of your thoughts about just you start dying. And now it's we all the way until now they still grown up and still your baby.
You gotta talk about that.
Absolutely. So it is in life. So it is in leadership. But that's what makes you such a powerful leader, Del Sister. Because when you are with them, when you on the stage, when you telling them, hello, somebody, they can feel that deep love flowing out of you. That's it. You remember that moment in Sly Stone's song, Sing a Simple Song, with Larry Graham says, I'm loving, over loving.
Yes, over loving.
And how do you learn how to overcome by over loving? Woo! Can you over love the truth? Overlove beauty, overlove goodness. Christian like myself, I'm overloving God. What is to overlove God? It's to allow that love to flow through you. So when people interact with you, they say, oh Lord, that Nina got that overflow going. Hello, somebody.
Hello, somebody.
Hello, when?
Woo, God, it's overflowing.
All about.
Yes, it is.
Yes, and it's a beautiful thing when Coltrane's blowing on his horn so deep that his neck is. It's breaking loose. He takes the horn, throws it on the ground, starts beating his chest. They say, Train is overloving. He's overloving us because he's trying to touch our souls in such a way that we are overpowered, so we are enabled, so that everything inside of him, he's emptied out, call it kenosis, is donated, is given out to somebody else so that they can feel better about themselves. They can do things they didn't think they can do. They can have confidence in ways they've never thought they had confidence in. That's what it is to love the people.
Can we find some overlove in this moment of heaviness and tragedy and people just, they feel in all types of ways right now, Doc, don't know what to do. Can we find some overlove?
If we brothers and sisters have folk in the past, and I'm talking about black folk at the moment, 244 years of slavery, average slave dead at 27 years old, tortured from the morning to night, and they kept overloving. If they can overcome and overlove in the panic with a neo-fascist gangster in the White House, depression-like levels of unemployment and underemployment, all kinds of despair hitting us, we can still overlove.
We can overlove. Let's overlove.
Lord,
that's over love.
Love, that's Larry Graham. That's like, oh, that's it.
That's it.
We want love and the need of love. Coltrane, love supreme. Tony Mars is beloved.
Yeah.
Love ethic. James Baldwin, love forces us to take off the mask. We know we can't live within, but fear we can't live without. That's the love warriors, and they all season. They're not just some of them. So
come on.
They all seasoned love warriors. That's the history of the best of black people, the history of the best of America, the history of the best of the human spirit.
And that's the history we got to grab on to, Doc. We got to grab on to that and not let it go.
The Italians got it, the indigenous people got it, the Russians got it, the Japanese got it. Oh, it's a human thing, but it's expressed in different forms. But they're the ones who overlove, who overgive, who sacrifice, and they usually end up crucified.
Yeah.
They usually end up misunderstood, just like that sister misunderstanding you.
True that.
You end up misconstrued. See, now that's the way the world is structured, because you know the world is dominated by domination. It's dominated by so much hatred and envy and revenge and resentment and things. And so you get these folk who love and overlove, they're cutting against the grain.
That's true, Doc. We're fed such a steady diet of negativity. I mean, to me, there's one thing to be informed. There's another thing to be inundated.
Yes, absolutely. That's exactly right. That's exactly right. And you remember what Brother T.S. Eliot, now he had right-wing politics, but he had a genius and a wisdom about it. He said, we moderns are distracted from distraction by distractions.
Mm.
So he's talking about weapons of mass distraction.
Yes.
And weapons of mass distraction is precisely that inundation you're talking about. Much of it misinformation, leading toward miseducation. So all these distractions on the surface, the superficial stuff. But what really matters, life, death, love, joy, service, sacrifice, that is pushed to the margin. And that's what a commodified culture is. It's a market-driven culture obsessed with just money, 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 money. And if people want to join the rat race, whoever wins the rat race is still a rat.
Well, you better talk about that. Just like choosing between the lesser of the two evils is still
it's evil. Still evil.
It's still an evil.
Don't deceive yourself. You got to be honest with yourself. You know what I mean? If you want the biggest car, if you want the biggest mansion, if you want all the money in the world, go on and take it if you can get it. But what does it profit a man or a woman to gain everything
and
lose their soul, lose their sensitivity, lose their morality, lose their kids, and suffer with Donald Trump? We know suffers from this. It's a very sad thing, actually. But he suffered from the inability to love. He never been loved. Can you imagine what life is like to go through not having no love? You can get all the pleasure in the world, but no joy.
That's it. Miserable.
Just look in his eyes and see it.
Yeah, you can.
And now Mary, his niece, has laid it out.
And misery loves company.
I'm telling you.
Yes.
That's real.
But Doc, you also said that justice is what love looks like in public. So.
Yeah. Oh, that's a beautiful thing.
That it is.
Oh, Lord, Lord. Yeah. You see, Randolph Niebuhr used to say, any justice that's only justice soon degenerates into something less than justice. Because you can't make it just on justice. You need something more deep and profound. You need that real funky stuff.
Mm.
See, get away from that deodorized level. Get into that funky stuff. Back to Ohio. Who's the teacher from Cincinnati? Felipe Wynn will teach you from Cincinnati. The Callaway brothers from Midnight Star and writing for Teddy Pendergrass Joy when he is in a wheelchair and is actually paralyzed from his neck down, and he got the number one song in the country called Joy. That's written by some geniuses from Cincinnati named the Callaway brothers. You see, that's Funksville. Because folk will keep the focus where it belongs, which is on vulnerability, the invincibility, the love, the joy, the sacrifice, the service. That's richness at its deepest level, no matter how much money other people have.
That's right.
See, if you got all the money in the world and your soul is empty, that's just the paraphernalia of suffering. Go on and get your teeth gold and lay out all the new watches you got and all the 55 cars in your garages and you're walking around and can't love. They just paraphernalia of suffering. You need a sensitivity. You need a little TLC.
Just a little bit.
Just a little bit of tender loving care. Somebody need to touch you in such a way that you understand what richness really is, not just how much money you got in your pocket.
You're talking about going deep now.
That's where we come from. I'm telling you. Oh, yes, what a great tradition. It's a human tradition, but old black folk in this country have been able to dish that out every generation.
Every generation. We love this country more than this country loves itself.
Isn't that the truth?
You know, I heard a sister say, Doc, she was out there protesting. I don't know what city she was in, but I caught a glimpse of her. And she said something like, I might be paraphrasing her, but she said that people are lucky. This country is lucky that all black folks want is justice and not revenge.
That's true. That's true. You know, I told Brother Anderson the other day.
You sure did.
I did, brother. If black people had produced a black version of the Ku Klux Klan, it would have been a civilization of a civil war every generation.
You sure said that, Doc.
We'd be American democracy. We'd have gone fascist a long time ago. They can't keep track of all the terrorist cells.
No, not at all.
But no. Here come Frederick Douglass. Here come Ida B. Wells. Here come Harriet Tubman.
The journey. Through.
Ooh, all the way to Nina Tana in Ohio, all the way there. Pass it on to Nina. Shirley Chisholm, pass it on. Fannie Lou Hamer, pass it on to Nina. I'm gonna say, I take it. That's
and
it.
And I'm going to pass it on to somebody else. Hello, somebody.
Oh, there you go. That's exactly right.
A relay race.
But you got it for a good while, because you're going to be around for a good while. The Lord is using you in a mighty, mighty, mighty way.
Well, you as well, Dr. Cornel West. You are a world-renowned, I say an intergalactic world-renowned, galactic. The world can't even contain you, not just this world, galaxies.
Galaxy. I've been trying to get on George Clinton's mothership for a long time. George, I want to come on, brother.
We going on that ship. Oh, Dr. West, I love you so very much. You have been a blessing. You are a blessing and a truth teller, and we are more than fortunate to have a voice like yours that many generations get a chance to either read your books, whether it's Race Matters. I remember the first time I met you, it was you were at a book sign and I had my little book, Race Matters, to get an autograph. And you show love to everybody. And who would have known all those many years past that moment that you and I, that God would bring you and I together to be on a journey.
Following you in terms of you being at the center of the Bernie Sanders campaign, and I would be blessed to be part of your family, that your intellect, your love, your generosity, your style enriches me, and that your family itself empowers me. I'm telling you, it's a blessing. It's a blessing. It's a blessing. You are a national treasure beyond measure.
Dr. West, you know what to say. We love you.
Hello, Somebody is a production of Large Media Network. Our logo and web design was created by Grace & Co. Special thanks to other members of the Hello, Somebody team. Tiffany Hale, Pepper Chambers, the hot one, Julia Griffin, Angelo Greco, and Anna Mesa. Now, if you would like to support our production, please become a member on patreon.com/hellosomebody. And finally, come join us for more conversation on my social media channels at Nina Turner.
That's that love connection that overflow from her soul to your soul. Do you understand what it is when she says, hello, somebody?